From my point of view, it's much more interesting to search for the fundamental problems with the idea. And therefore, this idea is very interesting because it poses a challenge to quite well-known principles. So I would like first to discuss a little bit the general background, namely to treat quantum computation as a challenge. So the first principle, which is less known to physicists, is what we can be called strong Church-Turing thesis. Of course, it is formulated in a different way than the original ones, and one can express it that any reasonable model of computation is essentially can be simulated by Turing machine. But one can think about, say, plain formulation, more rough, but I think this is exactly what we are interested in. Can we have a computer which is better than the classical digital computer equipped maybe with a random number generator? So another principle which is more physical, and I think it's also, say, more fundamental from the say physical point of view, is the Bohr correspondent principle. Again, the formulation is different from the rather modest observation of Bohr, but this is the definition which I found in Wikipedia. Classical physics and quantum physics give the same answer when the systems become large. One can try to make it maybe more rigorous, so I'll try to formulate it a bit in other words, namely that for large systems, the experimental data can be always modeled by classical probabilistic schemes. So the observables are represented by functions on certain phase space, and states are probability measures on this phase space. Of course, one can see a link between these two principles. If the Bohr correspondence principle is universally valid, then also this strong Church-Turing thesis should be true, because the classical models of computation were already discussed and checked, and they really support the Church-Turing thesis. The only resource which is still to be used is quantumness of the system. So if we cannot do quantumness in a scalable quantum information processing, then we cannot have better computational schemes than classical. Of course, one cannot expect that this kind of statements of principles can be proved in a single theorem. It's a bit similar to the second law of thermodynamics. So I think most people believe that this is that thermodynamics gives right answer, but we have rather scattered evidence. We have different type of simplified models. We have experimental evidence, but not a single proof which can show that the second law of thermodynamics is universally valid. In fact, I would like also to mention that there is probably a link between the second law of thermodynamics and Bohr correspondence principle. Okay, so let's discuss a little bit this strong form of Bohr correspondence principle. What are the supporting arguments? So we have many cases when we can analyze stability or, strictly speaking, instability of quantum states. And this analysis suggests that for large system, only a very small fraction of states, which are essentially almost classical, can be realized. There's also another argument I would like to mention. It's a classical character of quantum equilibria. So even if you have a large quantum system in equilibrium, in thermal equilibrium states, that the structure of possible equilibrium states is purely classical. The third example I would like to discuss briefly is quantum chaos. But what are challenges to Bohr correspondence people? The first one I'm not going to speak about, but it's very interesting. It's related to superconducting qubits. I do not believe also in superconducting qubits, but I don't want to argue about this today. another two challenges are, of course, fault-tolerant quantum error correction. And as a kind of maybe special case, the existence of scalable quantum memory. But the most attractive candidates for these memories are topological phase transitions. So first, briefly about the stability or instability of quantum states. So we have quite a number of physical examples that for large enough system, the eigenstates of Hamiltonians or the superposition are never realized in practice. So large systems like larger molecules are described by solution of some self-consistent Hardy equation, for example. Not original Hamiltonian problem for the system. The same is in nuclear physics. So large deformed nuclei are described by Hartree-Fock equation, which are called approximation, but essentially they produce different results than one would expect from the original Hamiltonian. Similar situation is for Bose-Einstein condensates or superconductors. We have Gross-Pitayevsky or Landau-Ginzburg equation, which are essentially classical. They are wave nonlinear equation for classical waves. What is the general interpretation of this facts? Namely, one should, especially for large system, take into account the interaction with environment. If you extend the system to include environment, therefore it's not a surprise that the result may be completely different from the results obtained for isolated system. And we have two different approaches, a kind of static approach when we discuss, for example, ground states of such composed system. And if you couple the system to infinite reservoirs, we obtain completely different dressed ground states, which are moreover very often disjoint, so you cannot have superposition of the states. And this is the mathematical description of absence of certain quantum superposition. But we have also dynamical picture, which is related. Again, the influence of environment produce a rapid decoherence of certain superpositions into mixtures. And therefore, we observe rather well localized classical-like states than eigenstates of Hamiltonians. Another class of arguments is related to the analysis of equilibrium states for quantum systems. So first of all, we use here a certain mathematical framework, which is for concrete, for example, lattice system is based on so-called quasi-local observables. So we start from localized observables, we extend them a little bit to have a mathematical structure of C-star algebras, and then we can study thermal equilibrium states. There is a definition of the states in terms of properties of correlation functions, which is this conditions which should be satisfied, are called Kubo-Martin-Schwinger conditions. And they are necessary to describe a real equilibrium with certain stability property, like, for example, passivity, which has thermodynamical meaning. And the standard picture is the following, that usually at high temperature we have a unique equilibrium state, but for many systems we have phase transitions at certain critical temperature, and we can obtain multiple equilibrium states. There exists a theorem which characterizes the structure of this equilibrium states, and the theorem says that the SkyMesh states form a simplex, so it's completely classical object. So, within this approach, there is no chance to hide quantum information into equilibrium states. But of course, the main objection and the main point for discussion is here. What are the accessible observables? In the standard approach, we use the observables which are obtained essentially from local one. One can, of course, ask the question, what about more general type of observables? So those which are used, for example, in quantum information theory, where we have a large system of qubit, but nevertheless, we can, in principle, perform measurement on each qubit. This kind of observables are not local. So therefore, this argument may be not convincing for many people. Another supporting arguments for Bohr correspondent principles related to quantum chaos. There is quite a lot of misconception in the literature, even textbooks, about the stability of classical versus quantum dynamics. Sometimes one claims that because the quantum evolution is unitary and linear, therefore it's more stable than the non-linear classical evolution. Of course, this comparison makes no sense. It's on a completely different levels. If you compare both theories on the same level, you will find that both of them are linear. Von Neumann equation for density matrix is linear in the same way as Liouville equation for the probability distribution of the classical system. Moreover, there is a large evidence concerning quantum system with classical chaotic counterpart, which shows that on the reason of the relevant time scale, there is no difference in sensitivity between classical and quantum systems. Here I present a typical picture. It is taken from one of my papers, but you can find dozens of such pictures which show comparison between classical theory and quantum for a chaotic system. So this is an example of a Baker map. So we have entropy production. It doesn't matter what is the definition of this notion at the moment, but it characterizes the stability of the system. So when entropy grows linearly, it means that we lose linearly information about the initial state of the system. And in the classical case, we have a straight line, and the slope is given by the sum of Lyapunov exponents or Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy. In quantum systems, we have exactly the same behavior, of course, up to a saturation point, because quantum system with finite dimension Hilbert space, they cannot absorb too much entropy, that they are finite in the sense of information capacity. But there is no difference between classical and quantum behavior on the relevant time scale, which is a logarithmic time scale proportional to the logarithm of the dimension of the Hilbert space. The longer time scale makes no sense from this point of view, because we lose completely the information of the initial state after this time. So let's consider now that maybe the most serious challenge to Bohr correspondence principle, namely fault-tolerant quantum computation. So first of all, I'd like to remind that the basic say, phenomenological assumption about the models of quantum computer or quantum devices. We start with some initial state of a quantum computer, and we obtain the final state by a sequence of evolution maps. Then can be decomposed into unitary maps, which are completely controlled by us, so they are composed of gates acting on one or several qubits. And of course, in between, there are error maps, which describe the phenomenological way the interaction with environment. Again, we have this decomposition of unitary maps into gates corresponding to the different locations. And what we have the following assumptions, which are necessary, as we heard from Daniel talk about threshold theorems. We need some assumption to prove this theorem. So the first assumption is the error map is linear. It doesn't need to be completely positive, and it is not generally only linearity matters in this approach. And the most important assumption is a certain estimation of the on the decomposition of the error map into L qubits subsystems. So the larger is the number of qubits which are affected by the noise, the lower should be the probability or the weight of such contribution. And to prove that theorem, we need this kind of exponential bound depending on the size of the subsystem. So under this assumption, we can prove what is called threshold theorem, which shows that if the level of noise is low enough, we can do quantum computation essentially for arbitrary long input and also for arbitrary long time with some moderate resources. So this was a purely phenomenological model. So let's try to derive the same mathematical structure, say, from the first principles. So we have a standard picture of the quantum open system. We have a total Hamiltonian, which consists of the completely, perfectly controlled Hamiltonian of the computer, the Hamiltonian of the bus, and the interaction Hamiltonian. We have also standard assumption about the product structure of the initial state, which makes sense in the weak coupling regime. And one can derive the reduced dynamics for the quantum computer. Useful tool is to write down the differential equation, which has a form of the master equation, what is called sometimes convolutionless master equation, but it should not be mixed up with Markovian approximation. It's in some sense a very trivial fact, which one can, for any evolution, one can in principle derive such master equation. What is interesting is the form of this operator L of T, which can be found within some approximation, usually using perturbation expansions. But having this form, of course, one should mention that generally this is not a Lindblad generator. So this L of T does not generate a completely positive dynamical semigroup. Only the total dynamics from time 0 to T is completely positive, but not the short time propagators. So now we can recover the phenomenological picture exactly the same, but now we have the map which are derived from first principles. So the error map are obtained from this convolutionless master equation. And you can ask about the structure of noise, which is hidden in the form of this linear operator. In general case, it's extremely difficult problem, but we can use a perturbation approach. And f of t, it's autocorrelation function for some bus operator which appear in the interaction Hamiltonian with in this general Hamiltonian form. And if this function would decay exponentially, then we could really use the assumption of fault-tolerant theory. But unfortunately, there are some physical reasons which give us a completely different behavior. So why this is important to find out what is the correlation function? Because in this expression, you can see that errors arrive from the past. And the weight of this error is proportional to the absolute value of this autocorrelation function. And if you assume the simplest possible situation when the reservoir is simply a heat bath at the temperature T, we know quite a lot about the behavior of this autocorrelation function for long times. Namely, because of this, what is called Kamen's condition here, but it's something very simple. It means that the probability of excitation from the lower to the higher level is given by the probability of the reverse process multiplied by the Boltzmann factor. This is something what is, I think every physicist knows. And because of this condition, one can easily check that the Fourier transform has a jump in the first derivative. And the jump in the first derivative produces a long tail in the function. And this is why we obtain here a non-exponential decay, which is given by 1 over t squared. So this is a generic decay for the heat bath system. We can try to reduce it by increasing the temperature, but it's not the case because also error of zero, it's temperature dependence, and generally it grows with the temperature. So it's not a good strategy to heat up quantum computer to reduce this non-exponential tail. So this is one of the objection to the say phenomenological approach. Now I would like to concentrate on another problem, namely of the existence of scalable quantum memory. It seems to be simpler than the case of say full quantum computation, because we want only to preserve the state and we do not make an operation on this, so it should be a simple task. We have also used a quantum computer as a quantum memory with all these gates, ancillas, and so on. And now one can ask the question, is there any fundamental difference between these two approaches? The quantum memory with a constant in time Hamiltonian, or this procedure with time-dependent gates and all these complicated procedures? I think there is no fundamental difference. Why? Because if you use a quantum computer as a quantum memory, we need to perform periodic in time actions. So the Hamiltonian should be periodic in time. And if you analyze the system with periodic Hamiltonian coupled to a bus, it comes out that at least in the weak coupling approximation, the structure is almost the same as for the constant Hamiltonian. It's in fact a well-known fact that periodic in time Hamiltonian are almost like constant Hamiltonian, because you can extend the Hilbert space and replace such a periodic Hamiltonian by a time-dependent, independent one in a larger space. So I believe that these problems of are essentially equivalent. So, how to construct quantum memory? So first, we need to design in a clever way a Hamiltonian for n qubits, which should have this property of self-defending against noise. So then we put the system into, say, heat bath at a given temperature. And because the Hamiltonian is constant, and if we assume that the spectrum of the Hamiltonian is reasonable, like in all interesting models of quantum memories, we can apply the weak coupling procedure to derive the Markovian master equation for this open system. And the structure of this Markovian master equation is very nice, so it has the Lindblad structure of the completely positive dynamical semigroup generator with the operators which should satisfy certain condition which looks like spectral decomposition of the operator with respect to this Hamiltonian treated as a super operator. So the commutator is treated as an operator. So this is an eigenvector and eigenvalue problem for operators. And here I assume that they sum up to sigma x and sigma y, because in this model I use a kind of generic model, because it's the simplest one and it's absolutely enough to consider this model for my purposes. Namely, every qubit is coupled to its individual private heat bath at a given temperature. So now that the construction of the generator is rather simple, I also normalized, I mean, the decay constants to one, and therefore have some extra constant in front of the generator, and we have the structure which has quite nice interpretation, the kind of excitation of the systems and de-excitation processes. And we have here this Boltzmann factor which describes the detailed balance between these two processes. So what kind of, what should we now try to prove? We should try to discuss and find out the ergodic properties of such dynamics. Is it possible to find some observables which can be attributed to encoded qubits which are stable with respect to this evolution? So the problem of quantum memory reduces to the construction of the observable, say, for a single qubit. We need, of course, for any size of the system, because we would like to have a scalable memory, so we increase the size of this memory. So for any size, we should define qubit operators and try to check their decay time or decay constant. It's given by the following expressions. It's not difficult to show that this is exactly the expression which describes the temporal behavior of these observables. So here we have a Gibbs state, which is an equilibrium state for this system coupled to the heat bath. And here we put the observable and the generator of this dynamical semigroup. And if this average decay rate goes to zero when n goes to infinity, we can say that we have a stable quantum memory. So one would expect that this of qubits, so this would be really an exponentially stable memory. So there is a well-defined mathematical problem for a given model, how to find out if such observables exist. And this is, in fact, quite interesting mathematical problem also, because it's related to the problem of the existence of gap in the spectrum of the generator. So one can use the techniques now in the field of spin system when one usually tries to find a gap for the Hamiltonian. One can use the similar methods as one can use for the Hamiltonian. So, what is now the meaning? Assume that we are able to find such observables, then this encoded qubit becomes metastable, and if you are lucky, the lifetime of this qubit would be exponentially long with the size of the system. But of course, this qubit observable should be also computationally accessible. So it means that if you perform measurement even of all possible qubits in a given basis, then we are able in a reasonable time to extract the information in what, say, state is this system. For example, take one observable x, so we should get a number. Either it's plus one or minus one. And if it cannot be done in the, say, polynomial time with respect to the size of the system, I would say that it's not a physical observable, because we cannot wait longer than the age of the universe to get this number. So now the question is to apply this idea to specific systems. So the most interesting are KTIF models, because they are simple enough to perform all this construction. So they have this property that the Hamiltonian is the sum of commuting terms, so there is no wave propagation, for example, in this model. It simplifies very much the application of this Markovian weak coupling limit and so on. And we can really say a lot about the dynamical properties of such open KTIF model. So this is a work in progress, partially done with Mark Fanes and Michał Horodecki, and also with Michał and Paweł Horodecki from Gdańsk. So what we have for sure is that for two-dimensional KTIF model, we have really a spectral gap over the identity operator. So it means there is no classical and no quantum memory in the sense what I defined. So we have the spectral gap is independent on the size of the system. So the observables decay with some, at least with some fixed decay rate. So it's the final result is not yet published. It's in preparation, but some, say, introduction to the topic is already published, and there are construction of the generator and some mathematical tools to deal with it. Much more interesting is a four-dimensional KTIF model. So the paper is still not finished, but what I can say with a high, fidelity, what is the most probable result? It's quite interesting, because one can find exponentially stable qubit observables for these models. It's not an easy task. It's quite complicated proof, and it involves also some very strong new techniques which allows to estimate the decay rate of observables for such generators. But I would say almost, 100% that the proof of the existence of this exponentially stable qubit observables is finished. So this is a good news for quantum memory, but there's also a bad news. So it seems that the algorithmically hard. So it means that even if we measure all the spins or the qubits in a given basis, we have to perform this computation to get one or minus one for, say, observable x. And there's a procedure, and this procedure looks like hard computation. So it really involves some we have to find some minimal surfaces over some loops and so on. So it looks really complicated, and therefore from the physical point of view, one can say that this is not a solution for the problem of quantum memory. It's like a perfect safe which cannot be opened even by the owner of the safe. Thank you very much for attention. I mean, for this model, I don't. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Okay. What I can say, but also not with 100% say fidelity, that this is algorithmically hard. So if there is any approximation, I don't think so. So because it's. So first of all, this result is for this, say, passive quantum memory. You ask about error correction in the sense of gates and things like that, yes? Okay, so this is, I mean, it seems that it's hard. It's four dimensional.
But actually, I wanted to ask about this too. I mean, in the 4D torque code, the defects are strings. And I would think that, you know, at a sufficiently low temperature, the strings are just, you know, isolated loops. And that doesn't seem like it's hard to decode. You're saying that it's not going to happen?
No, but in two-dimensional, you have a gap simply. You do not have any stable observation.
This is four-dimensional that I'm talking about.
You are talking about four-dimensional? Yeah. Yes, in four dimensions there is stable qubit observable, so you can construct this operator X, but they're extremely complicated. So you need to really to solve some variational problem. You have to create a minimal surfaces over this whole set of loops, and then having solved this problem, you can somehow find out what is designed.
So sorry, the claim is that at any finite temperature.
At any finite temperature, all these results are for finite temperature. At zero temperature, that all these bounds which we use fails simply. So it's really a finite temperature result.
Okay. Two questions. So first of all, these results you proved for Markovian models.
Yes.
So maybe you can comment on what happens in the non-Markovian case. The second question is, could you just explain some more about your negative result for the 2D case? Why is it that the spectral gap implies its negative result?
Why the spectral gap implies negative result? Because if you the measure of stability, maybe from the second question, the measure of stability is decay time of the autocorrelation function. You put observable X, and you put evolved observable. The correlation between the prepared state and the measured state after some time. And if this autocorrelation function decays with some decay rate, this decay rate is a measure of stability. And we know that for two-dimensional case, it cannot be arbitrarily small. There is a bound which is independent of the size of the system. So for any size of the system, you have a certain definite bound on this decay rate, and also for the lifetime of the observable. But this bound is proportional to the Boltzmann factor, so at zero temperature, disappears. So at zero temperature, we do not have any, any objection, say. And the first question was? Okay, I think it is key type models are so perfect, so for the weak coupling approximation, that I do not think that spoiling this Markovian picture would bring anything. So, because all these conditions we know, yes, about this Bohr frequency separation of time scales are really perfectly fulfilled, and they are independent of the size of the system. So for many models like Heisenberg models, we have wave propagation and we have continuous spectrum, and then Markovian approximation fails. But for this type of model, it's perfect.
Okay, maybe one more question. Okay, this is,
I have a comment and a question. So about the two-dimensional diaphragm, I think really all you're saying is that at finite temperature, pairs of defects will be created and diffuse around. Initial quantum state ground state manifold will be forgotten. And I don't think I'm going to be surprised by that. In the four-dimensional case, I think the questions indicated that they thought you were talking about decoding, but you actually said that the encoding is algorithm would be fine. So I believe that if you started out with a perfectly encoded state that turned on the thermal noise and the temperature is low, there is a decoding algorithm that works. I think
it's another picture, because I always start from the thermal state and the hyperterse system. Yes. 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 That this is algorithmically hard to extract this information. It's, you know, it's, the environment acts like a thief, which want to steal this information. And unfortunately, the same is for the observer. So the system protects also against the user of this memory.
Okay, so let's thank Robert again.